Now, an alarming report produced by the Salvation Army says Pasifika people are now worse off than they were prior to the 2007 global financial crisis. More than churches, rugby and festivals is one of the first reports on the state of Pasifika people in New Zealand. It has highlighted some things we already know, good and bad. We are, for example, the poorest in the land. The Pasifika unemployment rate is nearly three times the rate of unemployment of the rest of the country. Between 2007 and 2012, the New Zealand average weekly income for working adults rose by $54. For Pasifika, the average earning only went up by $2 in that five-year period. At the end of December last year, almost 13% of working-age Pasifika people received a work and income benefit. That's around a staggering 24,000 people on that benefit. The report also shows a huge increase in demand for food parcels. Back in 2007, 1,140 food parcels went to Pasifika families. Last year, the Salvation Army provided more than a whopping 6,000 food parcels to our people.
To discuss the report further, we're joined by one of its authors, Ronji Taniello. First of all, Ronji, thanks for joining us. No surprises really in the report. What happens though if we don't do anything about it?
I think one of the things that we've raised with the report is that we want to forecast that if some of these issues aren't dealt with now, then it creates further problems for Pacific people, but for the nation of New Zealand in the future. And so some of the story is quite worrying, especially when we look at Pacific people in Australia, as we have in the report. And so if we don't get it right now, then we will suffer the consequences in the future.
What were the big areas of concern that you think really stood out?
Probably the biggest one was the work and incomes area around Pacific unemployment sits at about 16% of the Pacific workforce. So Pacific unemployment is running 2 to 3 times higher than non-Pacific unemployment. And so that's a major thing that's affecting our community. We also add into that the income gaps. And so Pacific incomes have grown, average weekly income have only grown $2 over the last 5 years. But when we look at non-Pacific people over the last 5 years, the average income has grown $54.
Why is there such a difference between Pacific and non-Pacific?
I think the figures are indicating that Pacific people tend to still be working in lower paid jobs instead of maybe working in higher positions inside a warehouse. Maybe they're still stuck in the warehouse floor working in manufacturing and so on. And so I think it's indicative of some of the locations where our Pacific people are working.
Okay, what else do you think is going to bring about change for, I guess, our whole community?
Yeah, but it's a bunch of different things that contribute to the answers, Marama. I think there's challenges in terms of making effective policy, which is one of the main challenges of our report. There's challenges to the politicians in terms of making brave decisions when we deal with Pacific communities. But there's also challenges to the Pacific community themselves to continue to respond and maybe own some of these issues a little bit more. So it's a constant stirring and trying to catalyse development.
Is that a challenge to, say, our traditional structures like our churches? I see, you know, the Salvation Army have put together this report. Yeah. What about some of our traditional churches? Do they need to step up and help the community more?
I think some of our churches are doing some wonderful work. Eh? So you've got some Tongan churches in South Auckland involved in social housing, community gardens and so on. So there's some of our churches that are making some good attempts. But I think there's still questions around the role of the church in future development for Pacific people. So since in the last census, 83% of Pacific people attended a church, 94% of that group was a Christian church or Christian denomination. And so what is the role of the Pacific church or churches in general in dealing with high debt issues and dealing with some of the violent offending that's coming through our Pacific community? So there's questions there. I don't have all the answers, but I think as long as we can stir the debate.
Well, there's a lot that you've actually covered in the report. Where to from here, though?
I think there's different policy suggestions that we've made. So we've discussed in the report possibly a return to the Pacific Wave unit that the Ministry of Social Development started in the early 2000s. So that's one, I guess, suggestion of something that we could possibly go back to. It isn't always about creating brand new policy. It's about looking at policies and programs that might have worked in the past and revamping them in the future.
Well, Ronji, thank you for coming in. Thank you for sharing with us about the report.
Cool. Thanks for having me. God bless.
And still on the topic of poverty in the Pasifika community, government announced its annual budget last week and the focus was again on keeping government spending under control. However, there were some modest gains which will benefit Pasifika people, especially in housing. Although, as John Utanga reports, maybe not immediately.
Mene lives in a South Auckland boarding house with his wife and three young children, what he wants is a proper home for his family.
The boarding house is not an option like a long term, but if you are in a stuck situation and you're trying to budget, you got no choice, it's the best place to be.
Mene's lived here for 4 months and works part-time, but is hoping to gain full-time employment soon.
But it seems like we're going backwards, not forwards, with housing, you know, and affordability, with trying to get your own home, and with Housing New Zealand status, it's not looking too good.
Housing's a big focus for Budget 2013. Government wants to improve delivery of what it calls social housing. It'll do this by putting $27 million over 4 years to extend the income-related rent subsidy to community housing providers. It'll review tenancy so state houses are available for families with the highest needs, and it'll extend its home insulation scheme by $100 million over the next 3 years. It'll also introduce a kind of warrant of fitness for state houses.
Credit where credit due, at least they're going to be insulating some houses. Certainly they're going to be extending houses, you know, more bedrooms, insulating homes and building warrant of fitness. It could have got, you know, there should have been a lot more. One of the things that I don't think that the government truly grasps is the level of poverty. And poverty is a word that I don't think the government like to use.
Other areas which benefits Pasifika people include education, health and social development. In education, $41.3 million in equity funding has been put into early childhood education, and $5.9 million has been added for a mentoring program to help students achieve NCEA Level 2. In trades training, Māori and Pasifika will benefit to the tune of $43 million over 4 years. In health, there's $21 million for rheumatic fever prevention and $35.5 million for diabetes and heart disease. In social development, there's $1.5 million for budgeting services to help Pasifika families and $35 million has been set aside in contingency for extended family members caring for children. For the Education and Pacific Affairs Minister, it's a budget that can help Pasifika people.
We've got more specific funding to raise the participation by Pasifika infants and toddlers at early childhood level. We've got more funding to help teachers understand what's happening around national standards so that they can work with individual kids. We've got funding that's focused on mentoring for the kids that most need it, and in many cases that will be Māori and Pasifika kids.
However, opposition MPs say the budget has let down vulnerable people, many of whom are Pasifika, particularly in these tough times.
Oh, it's quite depressing, really, because there were so many promises of brighter future, promises of more jobs, but the reality is for our communities, that's not the case at all. In the last five years, 2007-2012, incomes only lifted by $2, while for Western New Zealand, they were way, way better. For unemployment, we're double what it was in 2007, and for young people, it's worse now at 43%, ages 15 to 19. Worst record in the world, where you've got global youth unemployment at 12.2%.
But that's not the only issue government and opposition disagree on. Su'a William Seor says there's been a cut to the Ministry of Pacific Islands Affairs to the tune of $861,000. However, the minister says there's been no cut, and in fact the money is money not spent but brought forward from the last two budgets.
She says that there's been underspending in the last two budgets. And that begs the question, well, what has she been doing for the last 2 years? No wonder our income levels are worsening. No wonder our unemployment rates are worsening under her government's watch.
Meanwhile, boarding house resident Mene just wants to get ahead, having moved back to Auckland from Napier to find work. He's been to Housing New Zealand already, but is not holding his breath.
It seems like cost of living is going up. The housing prices are skyrocketing. And you have to work extra hard to earn the money, you know, to actually finance yourself within your own family. It's tough. It is really tough. Not like maybe good old 7, 8, 10 years ago, it was a lot easier. But now it seems like every year seems to get harder and harder for your normal worker, you know, with the minimum wage to go through.